Okay, so can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay, can you see the slides? And
yeah, perfect.
Okay, so let me start by thanking you for the invitation to give this talk and also for attending it. So I will be just discussing a little bit about my discrete life in the swampland, which especially due to the confinement has been more or less like that. And I'm happy to have some company in this endeavor by my three excellent students which participated in this work. And they are Ginevra Brati, Jose Calderon, Minino, who are probably around in the. So let me give you some outline of the things I'd like to talk about. I'd like to talk about discrete gauge symmetries, hence the name, and based on that, in the spirit of the swampland program, I will propose the conjecture, which has to do with what happens with gauge couplings when you have a discrete gauge symmetries in your effective theory with a very order. Then I will test during my supersymmetric ABS vacuum, and later on I will have some discussion of the role of some discrete symmetries going to do with scale separation in the sitter and the anti-de Sitter distance conjecture. And then I will just conclude. So as general introduction, it's very hard to overstate the importance of the program, as I guess everyone is aware of. It is of effective theory from quantum gravity. So it goes to very deep questions in physics. So there are many different conjectures which are related in many different and interesting ways, and which are related to also so many properties of effective theories and UV theories. And today I will just focus on a class of such properties which are related to discrete symmetries. And because in quantum gravity we don't expect the global symmetries to exist, I mean discrete gauge symmetries when I say discrete symmetries, okay? So I will have some introduction about how to discuss efficiently these discrete gauge symmetries and in what kind of avatars they appear in the applications that I will have in mind. Since I know that you're very busy people, and many of you maybe leave the seminar before it's finished, let me start with the end, which are the conjectures. So the first conjecture is that we propose that in a quantum gravity theory with a discrete set K gauge symmetry in the very large K limit, and with a U1 gauge symmetry with coupling G, the gauge couplings scales as a negative order one power of K. So they go to weak coupling as K becomes large.
Angel, sorry to interrupt. Could you switch off your camera? Because sometimes the sound is not great. Maybe that helps. Thanks.
Okay. Let me do that. Yes, my bandwidth maybe is not that great. Parar video. Is that okay right now?
Yes.
Okay. So... I guess I'm still sharing the screen. Is that correct? Can you see the slides?
Yes, it's fine.
Okay. This is the first conjecture in which I will spend most of the time. There is a second one which has to do also with discrete symmetries, which we baptized set K refined the strong anti-de Sitter distance conjecture. The idea is to extend the distance conjecture proposed for anti-de Sitter, which has to do with scale separation when you go to the flat space limit. And just to pose it properly, the idea is to consider quantum gravity on some ADS vacuum, which should be supersymmetric according to other swampland constraints. And we assume that there is a set K discrete symmetry, but not acting on particles, but rather acting on domain walls. So the natural theme to which this couples is some kind of discrete three form. And we consider it. So when you go to the flat space limit of vanishing vacuum energy, there exists an infinite tower of states with a cutoff, which is related to the vacuum energy, but in this way related to the discrete symmetry order. So it's a refinement of existing strong ADS distance conjectures, as I will discuss. Okay, so these are the results. Let's see how we get to them. And under what circumstances they can be more or less rigorously motivated or derived, and what kind of tests we have for them. So let me start saying that I'll just focus on abelian set K gauge symmetries. There may be extensions for non-abelian groups and so on, but these are kind of more harder to discuss. So I will just start with the abelian ones. And to discuss discrete gauge symmetries, the prototype description is starting with a Higgs model, basically. So we consider a theory with a continuous U1, which is broken by some scalar web for a scalar with a charge K. So we parameterize a scalar like that and focus basically on the physics of the phase. So there is a gauge invariance for the U1, which is the standard gauge invariance for the U1, and then a shift of the phase by a factor of K regarding to the parameter with respect to the parameter of the gauge U1 gauge transformation. And the typical action once you give a BEP and integrate out, let's say, the breathing mode, the modulus of this scalar field is something like that. There's a kinetic term for the gauge field, and there is this kind of a coupling where basically the U1 is eating up, the photon is eating up the scalar with a factor of K in here to be consistent with this gauge transformation. Now, there are several dual descriptions of this worked out in a nice paper in 2010 by Banks and Cyber, also by other people. One possible the action to a two form, and this gives you some kind of a Stueckelberg action, where you have a kinetic term for the two form, which is a gauge field, Stueckelberg coupling with topological coupling. And in some natural normalization, the factor K here is an integer and has to do with the order of the discrete symmetry. The question is to dualize the photon to the magnetic photon. So you still have a Lagrangian with a two form kinetic term in here. And now the description of this mixed term comes in this way, in which basically what happens is that the two form, which was dual to the action, is eating up the magnetic photon dual to the electric photon at the beginning. And this dual action has a gauge invariance, which is a standard gauge transformation for the two form, and then some inhomogeneous shift for the magnetic magnetic photon. And this is another interesting description for these gauge symmetries. So basically, using this description or any description of discrete gauge symmetries, the smoking gun for the existence of discrete gauge symmetries in your theory is that the set K charge particles and set K charge strings. Okay, and the gauge invariance that we saw in the previous transparency implies certain dynamical properties for this for the charges carried by these guys that have to do with this set K factor. For instance, if you take K particles of charge one, they can annihilate into some process, which is some instanton, which is the instanton that couples to the action, basically. And if you take K strings, they can annihilate to a monopole line. This just follows from the gauge invariances we discussed a moment ago. This, all these properties imply that even though there are no long-range fields for these symmetries, this so, or if you take part, you pick up these kind of phases in the path interval. Okay, so although we discussed these properties in cases where there was some underlying continuous U1 symmetry, there are many situations where there is no obvious underlying U1. For instance, when the discrete gauge symmetry is coming from some discrete, then there is no obvious U1 where the discrete symmetry is coming from, but still many properties like this and strings false, all the features are just the same. Also, when you have discrete symmetries coming from a torsion homomorphic assets. Okay, before going there, let me emphasize that this story that we had starting with a one forms eating up axions or zero forms, you can generalize to a higher P form in dimensions descriptions. You can talk about a P plus one form eating up a P form. This would be an analogous of a one form eating up a scalar with charge K, of course. Or you can talk about the dual picture where you have the dual N minus P minus three form, where N is the number of space-time dimensions, which is eaten up by the dual N minus P minus two form. And you have also the mixed description of a topological coupling between different forms, which is the analogous of the Stueckelberg coupling. This is useful to discuss some other discrete symmetries that I will be exploiting that act not on particles, but on extended objects of more dimensions, for instance, domain walls. So in four dimensions, if you go to these more general versions, you can also find the dynamical systems, which are like the Valley Calopressor box, this corresponds to setup where P is, and there are again different descriptions. You can have a description which is similar to the Stuckelberg coupling with one action and a form, the topological mixed coupling with some integral coefficient here. Or you can have a dual pictures where, for instance, there is a dual two form, dual two is a scalar to this action, which is eaten up by a three form with a factor like that, and which shows this kind of a gauge invariance. There is a standard gauge transformation for the three form, and there is some inhomogeneous transformation for the two forms. And again, there are similar stories to objects annihilating into objects. In this case, K domain walls annihilate into strings. And as I mentioned, this is related to the action monodromy setups proposed by Silberstein-Westphal in the inflation framework, and which has been extended by many other people and studied in many setups, where basically you have some scalar with a multivalued potential such that you have some discrete periodicity. Okay, so let me start applying these ideas about the discrete gauge symmetries to derive this or to propose this weak coupling conjecture that I was mentioning at the beginning. And I will start with a heuristic black hole argument that is not perfect, as many black hole arguments, but I think it's a good motivation for the proposal. So let me just start reviewing how one derives the weak gravity conjecture using black holes. For instance, one can start with some extremal black hole like that, and then propose that it should decay in some way, and then it should become a sub-extremal. That means that the theory should contain some super-extremal particle in the sense that the mass is smaller than the charge in suitable units, and this we will call the weak gravity conjecture particle. Okay. Let me do another argument with black holes, which was basically studied by Valli. Oh, and here let me just mention that in this inequality, the equalities for Susi, as was proposed by Oguri and Baffa. And this is something that will be implicit in most of our discussion, which is better suited for supersymmetric cases. So let me go to the argument due to Valli and applied in many setups, which is often quoted as the species argument or species bound. So let me start with some, in this case, a black hole with some mass and then some discrete charge, which I take to be ZK, and let's say that the black hole has charge K. The idea is that this black hole will start decaying like democratically, preserving the ZK charge, because there are no long-range fields that surround the black hole, so there is no preference to emit one particle or of different charges. So the charge is maintained until the black hole becomes small enough to some critical radius, such that it can start noticing something like the size of the short range interactions or something like that, and then it can decay into something that allows the discrete charge to be evaporated. By the time this black hole reaches this scale, the mass is given by this quantity here, and still there should be enough mass to emit order k ZK charge particles. This gives you basically this bound. So this is usually called the species bound. Probably you have seen this, this formula in many. Okay, so we kind of propose some kind of mixed scenario where we have both continuous and discrete charges, and we will use them to derive this weak coupling conjecture. So the basic idea is that we start with a black hole which carries both continuous charge, and we take it to be extremal in this case. And because the theory has some discrete symmetry, we endow the black hole with some discrete charge, say it's order k units of a ZK symmetry. So the black hole is evaporating basically by emitting weak gravity conjecture particles until it becomes small enough such that it can decay in this way. So the basic idea that we will have in mind here is that in many situations, the weak gravity conjecture particles that the black hole is emitting are also the ones that will be used for the black hole to get rid of its discrete charge. So both relations, let's say, apply. And in fact, both will apply as equalities in the supersymmetric case. So we will have that the mass of these particles will be related to the charge, and the mass of the particle should be smaller than this power of k. So these two relations are very similar, but this is true if the gauge coupling scales in a particular way. So the basic idea is that the gauge couplings of the continuous ones will have to scale in a way which is bounded by some negative power of k, in this case, k to the minus 1/2. And this is the basic argument. So the argument was admittedly sloppy. This equality we are taking here is valid only for supersymmetric, which is the better case. In other cases, non-supersymmetric cases, we cannot be so strict about it. So we will allow for G scaling as k to the minus alpha in the large scale limit with alpha some order one a quantity. Let me pause at this point just to see whether there are any questions.
Hi, I have a question, in fact, Angel. So what is the argument again for having the same type of the same set of particles, the ones that satisfy this continuous or discrete version? It was related to supersymmetry, right? I mean, why has to be
the statement that the particles have to be the same?
Yes.
The idea is to look at the decay of this extremal black hole in a way in which the weak gravity conjecture particles are saturated BPS bound. So basically, the black hole remains extremal all the way to the end. So that means that at the very end, where the black hole is has to emit its discrete charge, it will have to do it by emitting also BPS particles. So that's why both relations apply. Okay?
And in the non-supersymmetric case, then it's not so clear.
In the non-supersymmetric case, it's not so clear because at the beginning, the black hole could emit weak gravity conjecture particles, which are very super extremal. So this black hole is very sub-extremal, and that means that when it emits the last particles, which are the ones which are set k-charge, then there is no relation, no clear relation with any BPS bound, let's say.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So it could do it by emitting k-charge particles, basically.
I have also very possibly very trivial question. Would you expect this argument to hold also for objects which are not asymptotically flat?
You mean like in ADS spaces or things like that?
I am thinking, for instance, in 4D about strings or membranes with a non-trivial deficit angle or with a back reaction that generically explodes.
You mean objects of different dimension?
Yes.
Extended objects of different dimension. Well, again, it's not obvious for me because I cannot do any black hole argument. With the weak gravity conjecture, I would guess that it applies in a similar way. So by using the standard arguments that if they are D-like brains, D brains or similar like, one can do T-dualities and then relate U1s to two forms or three forms or zero forms like axions.
Okay,
so I would apply the usual strategy of T-dualizing relations without further thoughts. But okay. There is no direct black hole argument for these other versions.
Okay, mm-hmm. So it is just duality without any obstruction.
Mm-hmm. Sort of, yes. I would generalize it. And then it's a matter of testing it.
Okay, thanks.
In fact, we'll see some example for three-form symmetries, you know, in a sense. So for set k charge domain walls, where it worked.
Okay, thanks. Thanks very much.
Okay, so something I should mention is that in this discussion of the black hole, I could... So this weak coupling conjecture applies to any gauge coupling in the theory. So there is no relation at all between the U1 and the set K symmetry. It's not the U1 underlying the set K symmetry or whatever, it's any U1 in the theory. Okay. So it is a very general statement. Okay, so this is just repeating the statement. Let me just move on and argue a little bit. So before going to detailed test, let me give you another heuristic picture, which is very heuristic. It's just to have something concrete in mind. So the idea is that discrete set gauge symmetries, actinon particles, appear all over the place when you have a D brain, like intersecting D brains and so on. That's in the D brain action, you have this kind of topological couplings. So when you reduce to 4D, very often you get Stuckelberg couplings in this way. And that's in fact how the U1s that appear when you try to get the standard model disappear from the effective theory. In many cases, you can get some order coefficient here, which tells you that there is some hidden or some discrete symmetry in the theory. So the point is that if you want to achieve some large set K gauge symmetry in a theory, basically one way to do it is to have a large array for a given of this form here. Then of course this cycle has been wrapping, is wrapping many times, that the gauge coupling for this gauge theory will be small. And in fact, there is a clear relation of the same kind that we saw, that the gauge coupling will have to be that way. So this is a very heuristic picture. It doesn't have to be any statement because we have to do many other things that I'm not going to do. The test will be other ones, but this is a nice heuristic picture to have in mind, just to see how the different things, the gauge couplings and the set symmetries, could be connected in particular setup. So let's go to the tests. So basically, I will be testing these ideas in a holographic anti-de-Sitter setups. So the first one is to consider ADS5 backgrounds and to focus on orbifolds. So I will just focus on the simplest ones. That is, you take anti-de-Sitter 5 times S5 mod set K with n units of 5-4 Ramon-Ramon flux. So these are the holographic duals to these many quiver gauge theories which have been studied since these seminal papers many years ago, shortly after the Maldacena paper, basically. Okay. In this case, the continuous U1s will be coming from the isometries, continuous isometries of the compactification space. And we will just focus on one particular one, which is the most important one, the one related to R symmetry in the holographic dictionary. And about the discrete symmetries, because you have this orbifold, the quiver theory has some discrete symmetries. For instance, you know that there is this rotation symmetry in the quivers, where you rotate the quiver by its fraction of a circle. This is part of a larger discrete group, which is in fact a discrete Heisenberg group, which is generated by one element A in set K, which is the rotation of the quiver, another element B, which is some phase rotations, and they don't commute, so these two set Ks don't commute, but rather they anti-commute to some element which is central. This was worked out by Kukov, Rangamani, and Witten for the set 3 orbifold, and then extended by many other people, including my work with Alessandro Mino here. Okay. Let me just mention that although we will be focusing on the 5 sphere case, any other horizon manifold X5, at least for toric ones, all of them have particular set K subgroup of them, it's present for a very large class of models. So let's see what are the parameters of the five-dimensional theory that you get. I understand when I say that there is a five-dimensional theory, I don't mean that it is that there is any scale decoupling or whatever. It's just for the purposes of discussion, just in the same way that you discuss it in holography. So in the five-dimensional theory, you have different parameters and relations with all of them. So the compactification scale radius, which is also related to the anti-de-Sitter radius, is related to these parameters in the typical holographic way. This is the 5D Planck scale, and this is just the microscopic parameters of the string scale and the radius in terms of different quantities, in particular n, the number of units of flux in the 5-sphere orbifold, and k, the order of the orbifold. So the idea now is to look for particles which are charged under set k and u1, and these are the particles which are supposed to be the BPS1, so they satisfy the weak gravity conjecture, and also charged under the set k. Okay. And indeed, there are such particles. They are in the S5 case, they are called giant gravitons. In the orbifold case, they are known as d-baryons. And basically, they correspond to d3 brains, which are wrapped on the equator S3. And they correspond to some set K torsion 3 cycles in the compactification space. Okay, so this is one of these setups where the discrete charge can be understood as coming from a torsion classes in the compactification space. Okay, so the mass of these particles is given by this formula, where this R cube is just coming because they're wrapping the S3. And just changing units, you can see that you can write it in this way in terms of the Planck scale. And in this expression, you can see that they satisfy this typical relation, which is the species bound in five dimensions. Okay, so it's clear that these particles are of the kind that we were interested in to discuss the discrete symmetries. Now, if we think about these particles not with the perspective of the species bound, but rather from the weak gravity conjecture bound or the BPS property, the BPS property is written like that. This is the typical relation between the conformal dimension of the operator in the CFT, the antidesitter radius, which is the same as the internal one, and then the mass of the particle in five dimensions. And you can express it in this way, where in here we're identifying what's the gauge coupling, okay, which enters the weak gravity conjecture relation, and the gauge coupling computed either with the BPS formula or directly, it follows this kind of relation. And you can see that in Planck scale units, it decays as, in particular in this case, k to the minus 1/3. So it is a particular example of this weak coupling conjecture. Okay. At the end, the interpretation is fairly simple. Basically, when k becomes large, this modifies the gauge coupling of the theory, which is related to the sizes of internal volumes and other parameters in such a way that it goes weak. Okay, if you think about other U1s which are not related to the R symmetry, it works very similarly. They also have a weak coupling conjecture behavior or scaling with K. This goes in the direction of saying that for any U1 in the theory, it will have to behave in this way, and this particular example agrees with that. Okay, questions? Okay, move on. The second class of examples are ABJM compactifications. So basically, we have N theory on ADS5 times a set K orbifold of S7 with N units of S7 form flux. Or in the suitable regime, this corresponds to type 2A compactified on ADS4 times CP3 with N units of 6 form flux and K units of 2 form flux along the P1 embedded in CP3. So again, the continuous U1s will come from isometries and will focus on their symmetry. And the discrete gauge symmetry in this case we will have to have a closer look at this story. So from the point of view of M theory, there are some set K torsion classes in S7 mod set K. So there seems to be some set K symmetry in the game. Now from the point of view of type 2A, the way in which the discrete symmetries will appear is by a topological BUHF couplings in four dimensions, which are coming from the reduction of the 10-dimensional Chern-Simons strand. So we start with this coupling B2F2F6 in 10D. Because there is this F6 flux, you get this MB2F2 in four dimensions. But also because you have this K flux for F2, you end up with this K B2F2 prime, where F2 prime is the integral of F6 over the four cycle dual to this, this is a P1, apologies, this is a type. Because the tractable regime corresponds to the case where n is much larger than k, this term dominates and there seems to be some set n symmetry. So there is kind of a puzzle of which of these two symmetries is the true discrete symmetry in the game. So let us look at that in just some more detail. So the basic point is that very clearly from the type 2A perspective, there is some unbroken U1, which is a linear combination of two U1s, one under which the D0s are charged, and another under which D4s wrapped on four cycle of the internal space are charged. This combination is the one which is less unbroken by the BUHF couplings that I was mentioning before. The broken combination is the one that appears in the BUHF coupling in this way. And there are coefficients N and K. When you have this kind of situation, the true discrete symmetry is set N squared plus K squared. Okay? And what that means more precisely is that in this theory, you can have N Kaluza-Klein or D0 Kaluza-Klein modes in M theory or D0 brains in type 2A, which can polarize into K N5 brains or D4 brains wrapping a maximal circle. Okay, so because N brains can decay, there seems to be some set N because they turn into some set K, into K objects, there seems to be some set K. This is the origin puzzle before. Okay, but now if you look at this process more closely, it means that N Kaluza-Klein modes, each with charge N under this key broken because of this coefficient here, you see that the D0 brain charge this coefficient N, and K N5 or D4 brains, or the negative ones, each of charge K because of this, annihilate to the vacuum. So this broken U1 is actually violated by n squared plus k squared units. And that's the origin of this set n squared plus k squared. Now, in the limit of large n, this term dominates here, and effectively you have some effective set n symmetry. Okay, so the gravitational description is under control for n much bigger than k, and the discrete symmetry discussion is obeyed by discussing the emission or creation of n particles, which are this nkk or this zero grade here. Okay, so basically to check whether we are satisfying this weak gravity conjecture, sorry, this weak coupling conjecture, is to check the independence of the gauge coupling. Okay, so this is what we will have to test.
Sir Angel, can I ask a quick question? Yes. Is sure. In the large n limit, is it, you said it's n, it's not n squared?
There is a set n squared, but the point is that in this set n squared, the objects, these kk modes or these zero brains, they carry charge n.
I see, thanks.
So it's enough to emit n of them. Okay, so it is this quantity that controls the dependence of the gauge coupling. If you go back, let's say, to the black hole argument, what matters at the end is how many particles you have to emit all the charge. So in this case, it's enough to emit n of these particles because each one of them carries a charge n. Okay?
Right, thanks.
Okay. Okay, so again, we repeat the exercise. We take the parameters, let's say, in the M-theory picture, the typical holographic relation between the radius and n and k, the 4D Planck scale in this case, blah, blah, blah. And then we look at the masses of these charged particles, charged under the set k and the U1, and we know that interesting ones will be this Kaluza-Klein and modes in M-theory or these zero brains in type 2A. And one sees that, repeating the argument, one gets a scaling of the gauge coupling of this particular form, which satisfies, again, this weak coupling conjecture. Okay. Okay, so before moving on, let me just make one aside, which will be useful later on, which has to do with the fact that in this theory, we had two kinds of BPS states. The D0s and the D4s, or the KK modes and the M5s. Okay, so we have these two different kinds of states, and they have masses that scale very differently with N and with K. Okay, and they have very different set of U1 charges, yet they are both BPS with the same gauge coupling from the unbroken U1, because there is only one unbroken U1 with coupling G, which scales in this particular way. And the reason for these two things, which are which looks so different to be compatible, is that to obtain the gauge coupling of the unbroken U1 in terms of the gauge couplings of the two objects, let's say, of the U1 associated to the D0 brains and the U1 associated to the D4 brains, you have this kind of relation where the coefficients also scale with K and N. Okay, so basically to have a compatibility of these two kinds of objects to be BPS, the scaling of this G0 and G4 has to be in a ratio whose dependence on N and K should be very specific, and it can be fixed just in terms of symmetry and the fact that these two kinds of objects is BPS without any knowledge of the microscopic compactification space or microscopic details. Okay, of course, it is in agreement with the microscopic computation, which is this one with all details. But let me just say that this ratio follows just from pure symmetry, just from the statement that these two kind of very different states have to be BPS with the same to with respect to the same U1, if you wish, with respect to the same unbroken U1 charge. And this is something that we will be using later on for domain walls. Okay. So let me move to the case of the discussion of three forms, which will have to do with also with this scale separation in anti-de Sitter. Okay, so let me start with a general discussion of this scale separation. So I guess you know, you're familiar with the strong anti-de Sitter distance conjecture. The anti-de Sitter distance conjecture states that if you take some anti-de Sitter vacuum in quantum gravity and you try to reach the flat space limit, this lambda goes to zero, then there is a tower of light fields, that is, there is a cutoff which is becoming a light as a power with order one coefficient of the vacuum energy. The strong ADC, the strong anti-de Sitter distance conjecture, is that this alpha is a 1/2 for SUSY. I mean, let me recall that the non-SUSY cases are taken to be unstable just by the Uri Bafa proposals about the non-supersymmetric anti-de Sitters. So let me phrase this strong ADC as the fact that this cutoff scale squared divided by the vacuum energy should be of order one when lambda goes to zero in this flat space limit. There are many string examples of this. All the holographic cases, the ones that we have just seen, they satisfied, and there are many other situations where it is satisfied. And the question is whether there is some certain type. There are some models with metric fluxes which seem to violate this conjecture, but Font, Derith, and Ibanez showed that the naive effective field theory is corrected. And when you take into account the back reaction, let's say, of the fluxes in the geometry, the back reaction of the metric fluxes to the computation of the volume of the internal space, the strong ADC is satisfied and everything is perfect. Now, there seems to be an apparent violation of this strong ADC in some models which were worked out by the Wolf, Giriavets, Kachur, and Taylor, and also Ibanez and collaborators. So we call this kind of vacua DGKT, and we will focus on them and see what can be done about them. And the point here will be to say that these examples, they do violate this strong ADC, but in a very interesting way, which is related to the set K symmetry, and that suggests some kind of refinement of the strong ADC. Okay, so let me just review this DGKT vacua. Basically, they correspond to taking type 2A on some Calabi-Yau threefold with oriented folds and no six planes on fluxes. The fluxes that one introduces are the Romance mass and H3 flux. These two contribute to the tadpole, the same tadpole that O6 planes and D6 planes contribute. So they are more or less thought to be of order one. And in addition, there are four form fluxes on four cycles. And these are unbounded by tadpoles. So the idea is to scale these unconstrained four form fluxes with some overall parameter K and to take this K to be large. So in the paper by Kachur and collaborators, they worked out some example of T6 mod C3 with oriented force and so on. And they saw some particular scalings of all the different quantities with K in this particular way, like the volumes and the corresponding Keller volumes and the axions. To form axions, they scale as K^1/2, the overall volume like that, the dilaton and the three form axions like K^3/2, and so on and so forth, in such a way that, well, you obtain some Kaluza-Klein scale, just obtained from these Keller volumes here, and some vacuum energy, which they obtain by minimizing the potential, satisfying this kind of relation. Okay, so as lambda goes to zero, there is a cutoff scale, which is the Kaluza-Klein scale that goes to zero, but not in the power proposed by the strong ADC. Okay, and this is the puzzle that we wanted to address. So one possibility is to blame this problem into the fact that these configurations, they are defined in discussed in 4D, and they don't have an explicit 10-dimensional lift. And then there are different attempts to construct this 10-dimensional lift. They have not been completed yet, but so far the lift seemed to be okay in the sense that things that could have gone wrong, they didn't go wrong. So as far as we know, the 10D lift is still possible in a way which respects this kind of relation. So maybe it's not that the solution that we are looking for. Okay. Instead, we are trying to explain why there is this violation and what is hidden behind it. So the strategy is very heuristically is to rewrite this scaling of the vacuum energy and this scaling of the Kaluza-Klein cutoff scale in this particular way, which is very asymmetry in the game. And indeed, in a very sketchy way that we will refine later on, one can see that if you start from the 10-dimensional Chern-Simons couplings, F4, F4, B2, and you just notice that there are F4 fluxes on four cycles, there are some kind of a Kalopper-Sorbo with an order K coefficient because it's coming because of the four-form fluxes are scaling with K. So certainly there is a three-form the set K charges will correspond to domain walls. So there is some underlying form, which is the one associated with this.
I couldn't hear what you just said. Could you please repeat it?
Sorry, can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now. I just couldn't hear what was said before. Could you please repeat it? Because it seems very interesting.
Okay, so starting with the 10-dimensional Chern-Simons coupling, F4, B2, and turning on the F4 flux here, one sees that there is a De Valle Kalopper Sorbo coupling in four dimensions between the NSNS axions and the four-dimensional four form with an order K coefficient. So there is a set K gauge, discrete gauge symmetry under which domain walls are charged. Okay?
Thank you.
Okay. So this is a very oversimplified argument, just to give you the idea. We are going to the details in the next slide. Okay. So let me describe now my what I will call the agnostic strategy. So the basic idea now will be not assume the solutions as in DGKT, that is, not assume all the moduli and the dilaton scalings with K, but rather leave that dependence as free and derive those moduli scalings from the set K symmetry. Okay? And it's possible to do it, but we have to have a more careful look at the set K symmetry, more careful than in the previous transparency. The point is that on top of the F4, F4, B2 coupling, there are also other couplings between F0, B2, and F8. So that means that because there is the Romance mass parameter, there are couplings like that between the NSNS axions and different four forms, which are coming from F8 integrated on the different four cycles. And there are the couplings that we saw in the previous transparency coming from the NSNS axions and just the four-dimensional four form. Okay? So there are many different four forms, field strength four forms, and many different actions. The point is that there is one more four form than actions. Okay, so that means all the three forms will become heavy except for one, which will remain as a continuous symmetry for three forms, which is unbroken. So the story is very similar to what we saw in type 2A ABJM. There is one massless three-form combination, which remains light. Okay, let me call it QU1, which is this particular linear combination, which is orthogonal to this combination that participates in the De Valle Kalopper Sorbo couplings. And there is an approximate set K symmetry, which is coming from precisely a combination that appears, let's say, in these topological couplings. Of course, there are other massive ones, but the one I wrote here is the one that is leading in the large K limit and the one associated to the set K symmetry. And that is kind of manifest here because K is much larger than M, that I remind you is of order one. And now what we will do is to play the game that we did before. As in type 2A ABJM, we notice that there are BPS states of two kinds, the D2 brain with all forming a domain wall in 4D and the D6 brains wrapped on some four cycles. They correspond to different sets of domain walls, which are BPS because they carry charge under this unbroken U1. Okay, and the gauge coupling of this U1 is obtained from the gauge couplings of the two brains and the six brains in this particular way. And the fact that the two kinds of objects are BPS simultaneously with the same gauge coupling means that one can fix the ratio, let's say the K dependence of the ratio of these two different gauge couplings just based on the symmetry. Okay. So the coupling of the six forms is K times, goes like K times the coupling of the D2 brains. Okay. Now, if you go to the derivation or the computation of the gauge couplings, just in a, let's say, toroidal compactification, just from volumes and things like that, you can derive just from this scaling, which follows from the symmetry, that the Keller moduli have to scale like that. And the overall volume scales like that. You can play this game by in different ways. For instance, because there is some action monodromy here, you can look at what is the monodromy with fluxes, and it is consistent in this way. But because there is some extra piece here involving the three-form actions coming from the three-form, you can also obtain the scalings of other quantities, for instance, the actions partnering in the dilaton. And okay, so these are the coupling, sorry. This is the scaling of the actions coming from the two forms, the NSNS actions. They have to scale in this way to be consistent with this flux monodromy. And the dilaton and three-form actions, they have to scale in this way. Again, everything follows just from the symmetry. And all these relations, they are exactly as in DGKT, and they are the ones that allow you to derive that the Kaluza-Klein scale, scales like that. The point here again is that we were agnostic about the derivation and we were not using the scalar potential or things like that, just we were using the symmetry. Okay? We derived this Kaluza-Klein scale. Now it's time to derive or to say whether we can say something about the vacuum energy. And again, we took some agnostic strategy. Instead of using the scalar potential, we decided to compute the vacuum energy by using the tensions of the BPS domain walls. Okay. We focused on the domain walls, which are default brains, which are wrapped on two cycles, and because they are the ones that change the value of K, the four front fluxes on the dual four cycles, okay, in such a way that we obtain this tension, which comes from the this gauge coupling just comes from, let's say, the dimensional reduction with the moduli scalings that we saw in the previous transparencies. Out of that, you can get, with this gauge coupling and the charge, you can get the tension of the domain wall. And out of that, basically, you can use like junction conditions, if you will, derive what's the vacuum energy scaling with K. So overall, you recover this written in this way because it emphasizes the fact that there is a set K symmetry underlying all these scalings and responsible for the different scalings of lambda and MKK square. So this led us to propose this set K refined strong ADC, which is, as I mentioned at the beginning, that if you consider quantum gravity, some ADS vacuum, and there is some set K discrete symmetry for domain walls with a K large, if you try to achieve K goes to, which is controlled by the order of the discrete symmetry. So it's a refinement of the ADC, and it explains why these examples of DGKT seem to violate the naive strong ADC, but they obey a refined version of it that takes into account this underlying discrete symmetry. Okay? So let me make a couple of comments about the developers will try to explain these stories. Papers trying to find the 10D lift of this vacuum, they emphasize the role of some scaling symmetries of their equations in supergravity, in 10D supergravity. They smell a lot like set K symmetry because they are controlled by the by this quantity K, but the details remain to be spelled out. So I don't see a clear and obvious relation of these scaling symmetries and the discrete symmetry in the effective theory as we saw it. And after our paper, there were other papers that appear with ADS vacuum in lower dimensions where there seems to be variants of our mechanism at work. For instance, there was a paper of Lust and Chimpis where they were building ADS2 vacua by taking near horizon limits of Reisner-Nordström black holes. And in these cases, of course, you get a scale separation of the T4, but not of the S2, which is the size of the horizon of the black hole, basically, and is the same order of the anti-de-Sitter 2. And in this case, it looks like the scale separation of the T4 with respect to the other scales, not only of the ADS2, but rather of the ADS2 times S2. To understand that in more detail, one should be able to distinguish which moduli, the one separating this from the rest and not the S2, for instance, enjoy the set K and which don't. Another comment is that there was a recent paper by Van Riet and collaborators with orientifolds. And in this case, there are some set K topological couplings, but they are kind of projected out by the orientifold. So they are kind of underlying the theory before you took the orientifold. So we are trying to understand whether this plays some role or there is a different explanation for this scale separated vacuum. Okay, so I'm about to finish. My conclusions are the ones I mentioned before. We have these two conjectures, which are kind of relevant when you have a large order discrete gauge symmetries in your theory, either for one form, that is when you have set gauge charged particles, or for three forms, that is when you have a set gauge charged domain walls. So I hope you enjoyed these two conjectures, profit from them, test them, and let us know whether they are right or wrong. Thanks a lot.
Okay, thank you very much, Angel, for the talk. It was very nice. So Are there any questions? You can just unmute yourself and talk, I think.
Yeah, I will stop the recording now.
Great.